A very good evening to all. We are all happy to have you all here as a part of the webinar organized by Ayurvedic Shala today. Today being the fifth National Ayurvedic Day, we have opted a topic which we think quite relevant to the current scenario. We hope this would emphasize the importance of Ayurveda in the current society. So first of all, since it is Diwali tomorrow, Ayurvedic Shala wish all the people a very happy and safe Diwali. I think we can directly move on to the webinar now. First of all, let me invite our respectable Chief Physician, Dr. Madhavankutty sir, and our additional Chief Physician and Superintendent, Dr. Muralidharan sir, to the webinar. A very warm welcome to you both, sir. Then let me introduce the expert panel. First of all, let me introduce Dr. P.R. Ramesh sir, who is the working as the Chief Clinical Research of Kottakkal Ayurvedic Shala, and Dr. K.V. Rajagopalan sir, who is working as the Deputy Chief Physician of Ayurvedic Shala Hospital and Research Center, Kottakkal. A very warm welcome to you both, sir. And today's theme presentation will be done by Dr. Ullas K.V. He is working as a senior physician in Ayurvedic Shala Hospital and Research Center. Then, for the attendees, first of all, thank you for coming on board. And then you can put your queries and questions in the chat box, which we will be receiving during the presentation. And then our expert panel will be addressing the same during the time of discussion. Thank you. And I would like to invite Dr. Ullas K.V. for the presentation.
So, namaste. So, respected our Chief Physician, Dr. P. Madhavankutty Varia, sir. Additional Chief Physician, Dr. K. Muralidharan, sir. Chief Clinical Research, Dr. P. R. Ramesh, sir. Deputy Chief Physician, Dr. Rajagopalan, sir. And a warm good evening to all the participants and listeners in this webinar. As today is an auspicious day for Ayurveda, it's today's National Ayurveda Day. So today's theme is Ayurveda for COVID-19 pandemic. So it is a relevant topic considering the present scenario. So from the beginning, let me have prayer to our presiding deity, Lord Vishwambara, and our humble pranams to Vaidyaratham P.S. Vaidyar, who was the founder of Ayurvedic Shala Kottakkal. So this is the contents of this webinar. So I am not going to a detail of about COVID-19, the corona virus, because as these all are very the details are very familiar among the people through various channels. So I am going to the Ayurvedic part, what we can do in the present scenario. So this is the content of my presentation. So coming to the topic, Ayurveda, its aim. So its main aim is to improve the function of the immune system of the body. So immunity is a key word factor in the present scenario of COVID-19. So in order to its aim is to improve the function of the immune system of the body, as well as our health depends upon immunity, that is Bala. This immunity largely depends upon the metabolism of the body. In short, all medicines, treatments, and remedial measures should aim to ensure proper immunity and thereby a good health. So our focus should be mainly on immunity, hygiene, and health awareness. So regarding COVID-19, it is a familiar, it is not a familiar disease. It's a new thing for the medical science. So there is no direct link, a direct correlation, means a specific correlation of COVID-19 in with Ayurveda. But we can link some details, some contents in the Ayurveda with the nature of COVID-19 such infection. So in Ayurveda, indication of infectious disease is mentioned, and also in Susruta Samhita, is Aubasargika and Aganduja, and in Charaka Samhita, Janapadodhvamsaniyam. So, what is Aubasargika Rogas? Aubasargika Rogas is nothing but contagious disease. It is spread, it is said to spread from one person to another through physical contact. So many diseases are mentioned in that. And in Agatunja Vaidhi, it is a disease that the root cause, the causative factor is from outside, not inside, from outside that causes illness. So these two, the nature of the diseases are quite similar to the present scenario. There comes Janapadodhvamsaniya, that means it's the pandemic nature of the COVID-19 is very well, we can correlate with the Janapadodhvamsaniya. It is mentioned in Charaka Samhita. Usually refers to a pandemic or epidemic sort of disease involving a large group of individuals, community, etc. It may affect irrespective of their prakriti, their diet, their bala, physical strength, their suitability, that by age and other things. So in this way we can link with COVID. Next comes the balam, that is immunity. It has three divisions, that is sahaja, kalaja and yuktikrita. Sahaja means innate, that means what we inherited from our parents. Kalaja means season and age. It's in some season our immunity less. Like in the beginning of the rainy season, especially our metabolism will be it can be easily deranged. So immunity will be less. And in spring season, it may be the winter season, the immunity can be maybe more strong. And also age, young age, younger age people and or elder age people, they are weak immune people. So it may be can correlate like that. And yuktikrita means acquired, that means it can be acquired through diet, lifestyle modification and medication. So what we have to know is that it is not a easy way or a shortcut one can achieve immunity. It needs regular practice and get a proper immunity. So next comes the Ayurvedic management of COVID-19. It has three phases: preventive, active and post-COVID. Let me say that Ayurveda is more strong in the preventive aspect of COVID, this infectious disease like COVID-19. So there is two segments in Ayurveda that deals. One is Swasthavrata, means preventive aspect, and Adhiravrata, that is curative aspect. Swasthavrata means a Ayurvedic way of life, a healthy life. It has got three segments: Dinacharya, Rutucharya and Sadvrata. So Dinacharya means a daily regime. There is lot of points are there, things are there in the daily regime. One cannot follow all the regime in a single day, but we can do it judiciously, like wake up in the early morning, proper elimination of bowel and urine, right from the sunrise to the night, that good healthy daily regime, cleaning the teeth, application of collyrium, that is eye applications. Then we can select a suitable measures particularly to a condition. So the Nasim is a treatment, it's a method we can follow in a daily regime, that is nasal instillation of medicine. So one of the roots, entry point of the contagious disease, especially in this COVID-19, is nasal cavity, nostrils. So the administration of proper medicines through nasal cavity, that nose, can improve the health of nasal mucosa. Thereby, we can prevent the entry of the pathogens. And there comes gandusha, gargling. Gargling means suitable medical decoctions. Maybe it can decoctions or maybe oil, or it can like that. We can select, and we can use for oral hygiene. And also there is one thing: the saliva is in our mouth is a type of barrier which can prevent the entry of microorganisms. So if we make a proper hygiene, oral health, that is good for the preventive aspect. And there comes Abhyanga, oil massage, then Vyayama, that means exercise. Exercise is a very needful thing, because lifestyle diseases are more, and also in lifestyle diseases, the immune system will become weak. So in order to curb that incidence of lifestyle disease, exercise has got a major role. And then powder massage, then bath. Bath means this is very relevant in the present scenario, because considering the hygienic part, we have in the bath regularly, minimum 2 times, and when those go out to come back, definitely we need bath. So these are the points we have to see, and we can adopt what the possible, we can follow the possible methods so that our immunity, our strength can be maintained. Then the other segment called Ritucharya. Ritucharya is it is mentioned 6 seasons, but many of the seasons may not be feeling in our part. But the important criteria is that seasonal variations, seasonal changes, from one season to another season, it can have an impact on our body, our immune system. So we have to adopt certain lifestyle modifications, diet changes, and other things, so in order to maintain our strength, immunity. So these are the measures mentioned in very olden days, and which are very particular relevant, which has got very relevant in the present scenario. Then comes Sadvrtam, good healthy conduct. One should always eat after food, after the proper digestion of the previous food, and also what one should not hold the natural urges, the reflexes, and does not forcefully release it, because this natural reflexes, if we hold for a longer period, means repeated times, it can have an adverse impact in our body, not suddenly, but in the later thing. So these are the things which are we should keep in mind as a preventive aspect, Swasthavrta. Then personal hygiene, that is that we all know, one should keep this hygienic aspect, take bath regularly, keep feet, ears, nose, eyes, all are clean, our extremities, especially hands, should be properly clean, that we all are knowing, and what we are following nowadays. So these all are mentioned in our olden Ayurvedic classics very well. Then coming to the medicine aspect, so there is 2 types of medicine depending upon the action. One is preventive, that is, it's called urjaskar, that is bestow strength, preventive. That means rejuvenative. It is very good to rejuvenate the cells, the tissues, the body. And next is rogakana, that means curative for diseases. So what I am just mentioning, some of the preventive measures and medications, it may contain a medicine name, but we have to know that medicines in Ayurveda, the treatment is person, it is person, strict personally oriented treatment regime, Ayurveda. So one medicine may be good for one person, may not be, we can advise for other people. So these are the options I am mentioning. We have to see, it is under the supervision of advice of a doctor only we can take. So these are some of the medicines which are commonly used as a preventive measures are Indugandham Kashayam, Shadang. This Indugandham Kashayam is good for the proper metabolism of the body as well as immunity. Shadangam Paniyam, Villuadi Gulika is very commonly used for to eliminate the toxins from the body. Chyavanaprasam, very popularly knowing the formulatory, especially good for rejuvenation. Delay the aging process, the degenerative process. And next comes the Ayush Kwada Churna, which is a newly formulation made by Ayush department. It has 4 ingredients, cinnamon, tulsi, pepper, and dry ginger. It's very good for metabolism as well as immunity we are now using. Then some measures like, as earlier I have said, Pradimarsa Nasya means Nasya, the nasal incision in small quantities. Anudailam is one among that medicine. in the seasonal variations also, and also for the nasal hygiene we can use, and to ensure oral hygiene, cleaning of mouth. These all are the measures we can adopt as a preventive aspect, and especially in the last environment disinfection with abharajita dhoopa churna mentioned in ashtanga hrudaya in the context of jara chikitsa. This is now widely used in part of Kerala as a disinfectant. It's a powder and we can use as a fumigation. Then this is a geriatric group. What we can give is chyawanprasha, ashwagandha, ashwagandha churna. These are what I have mentioned is time tested medicine, may be good for it can be advisable for the old age group, but depending upon the condition we have to everyone cannot take the same formulation. These are the options. Time tested medicine can be a good option. Then comes this active phase, in the present scenario we are not in a position to treat active cases due to some other matters, so generally we can say once the situation changes we can move on. There are good options in Ayurveda that can be tried when the situation changes. So the active phase cold, COVID is a common symptom which are very everyone is knowing that thing, cold. So this cold normally it will subside with 2-3 days, but if it is prolonged and going to an throat infection or fever, then we have to think about a chance of infectious fevers like this COVID-19 or something like that. Then we have to be more vigilant. So the cold can change to a COVID, that we have to think about. So what I am just mentioning some of the medicines as a symptomatic, but these are the medicines we can think about when the situation changes. We have a lot of options, but at the present situation what we are mentioning is with our experience from the colleagues from other parts, and also after discussion we can think that such medicines will be good and can be used if the patients are low risk people that are having no less comorbidity. So that also is a option what we think. So next comes the post COVID therapies that Ayurveda ray of hope. So after COVID, once the convalescence period finished, so we can think about patients they may get lethargy, they may get anxiety, insomnia means the sleeplessness, shortness of breath, because this COVID-19 has got a huge impact physically, socially, financially, so many factors are there. So people used to get sometimes more affected by the this disease. So usually seeing lethargy means tiredness, and anxiety, insomnia, sleeplessness and shortness of breath, these are the symptoms usually seeing. And in insomnia, stress and lethargy, these are the formulations we can try depending upon the situation, I mean the condition of the patient. This and then one of the medicine ashwagandha churna used to give in so many conditions it's a nervine tonic, it's good for mind, it's good for the strength of the body, it's good for the immunity, is very commonly used medicines, and formulations are there for other COVID complications also. So post COVID, what is the preferable diet? It is this nutritionally balanced food is preferable. Light food and timely food is very important. Make sure the digestion is perfect. So it is not the quantity of the food, the quality of the food, as well as the time of the food. Food is very important because it is direct, because as per Ayurveda, it is the digestive power, it is called Agni, is very important. So one should consume food if we have proper digestion and the hunger. Drink plenty of water, take adequate quantity of fruits and vegetables, and preferable activities are regular exercises and yoga, proper sleep, maintaining personal hygiene, and some of the herbal herbs. That means we have to, means it is good if we keep in our home so that we can use wisely. Dried ginger, coriander seeds, turmeric. Dried ginger is a good appetizer. It's good for appetite, gastric problems. It's antiviral property. Dry ginger, without dry ginger, there is no other, the kashayam without dry ginger. It's wide use in Ayurvedic formulations. Coriander seeds is good for the gastric related problems. Turmeric is very good herbs, which is good for the it's good for immunity, and also this as a good immunomodulator, it is very good, especially in hypersensitivity, allergic conditions. Then comes tulsi. The turmeric powder with the tulsi, we advise in people who used to get cold, rhinitis, upper respiratory tract infection, usually. So we advise them. And neem leaves is a good anti. It's good for skin as well as in good for so many conditions. Fenugreek seeds is good. Seeds is good for bowel clearance, good for stomach, and also it will reduce the sugar level in the body. Pepper, definitely it is an antiviral, very good. It's good for digestion, and also it always enhances the bioavailability of the medicines. Asafoetida, then hing and garlic, cumin seeds. These are the if we keep such herbs in the our home, it can be wisely used in such a immune response in such conditions. So the takeaway message for this presentation is 3H for life: help, heal, and health. Help the community, heal the affected, health for all. Thank you. So this
thank you, Dr. Ullas, for the clear and detailed explanation. Now I think I would like to request our expert panel to share their views on this topic. Ramesh sir, could you please share your views on this topic, please?
Evening, everybody. Am I audible?
Yes,
am
sir.
Am I audible?
Yes, yeah. Sir.
Good evening, everybody. First of all, let me wish you all a very happy Diwali. And of course, the Ayurveda Day, the Dhanvantari Day, which is a very auspicious event, especially not only for Ayurveda, but for all. Actually, this is the fifth Ayurveda Day celebrating in India as a national Ayurveda Day. But before that, this was the Dhanvantari Day. Lord Dhanvantari, we all know that actually he is supposed to be the healer. He brought Amrit, nectar, and to cure all the ailments. And it is a strong idol of Ayurveda, representation of healing and love to humanity. So this day is very, very auspiciously observed. It is not celebrated, actually. It is actually very auspiciously observed. And the Ayurvedic fraternity, with a determination to serve ailing humanity. So that is the importance of this Ayurveda Day. Moreover, as discussed very beautifully by Dr. Ullas, he has given a very good presentation with a brief introduction about all aspects of COVID management as well as immunity. So in the present scenario, the immunity, again, we have to tell that Ayurveda has become more relevant in the present health scenario, because there is a transition of disease from communicable to non-communicable disease. This was the observation in the 21st century. But now the COVID pandemic has completely changed the health scenario. So actually, what will be our health scenario, that we will only come to know after this pandemic is over. So in the post-COVID scenario, we need to address so many issues with immune system problem, because we are getting post-COVID cases now, which have mainly respiratory issues, cardiac issues, and post-COVID stress syndrome. And in children, immunity-related issues, because there earlier they were not having much problem, but now they are having very frequently getting many kinds of infections, illness. So the immunity is very, very low. So in the post-COVID scenario, what I was trying to explain is that actually we should have a very vibrant immune system always to resist any kind of infection. So it is very, very important. And that is the main message of this day. So for immunity, Dr. Ullas has already told you, not simply taking medicine. You should have a healthy lifestyle. You should have nutritious diet. Exercise and metabolism and good sleep and your hereditary factors, human microbiota and vibrant metabolism and your stress, because stress also reduces immunity. Along with that, if you have immunomodulatory type of medicines and activities and proactivity, it is a very, very important factors to give you a vibrant immune system. So I would like to tell you that actually you should have a very good healthy lifestyle, regular exercises, and please be please be regular in your traditional diet, instead of going for all kinds of artificially flavored bakery and all that kind of junk food. Stick on to your traditional diet, which is very tasty and very healthy for, and adding all spices. In India, we use a lot of spices, which has got lot of antioxidant property, and lots of fruits and vegetables included in diet. Have regular exercise, have good relation with your family, and enjoy your life. And that will take care of your immunity, and that will be the real health that is boosted for you to keep away from all kinds of infection. With these few words, once again, I thank all of you for your patient hearing, and then we will, in the question answer session, if anything is there, we will interact. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Now I would like to invite Dr. Rajagopal sir. Sir, could you please share the views?
Good evening, Dr. Anu. Can you hear me?
Yeah, sir. Yeah, I can.
Okay, thank you. Happy Diwali to all. So, initially, I would like to take your kind attention to the statement our respected Home Minister, Srimati K.K. Shaija teacher, told recently. That is, you have to be very careful on the cases of post-COVID scenario hereafter. In such a case, definitely you have to make use of the Ayush system of medicine. That was her statement. In that case, I think that will make a glance of importance to the people who are unaware about the Ayush system of medicine. And she again says that if any symptoms like headache, chest pain, breathlessness, lethargy, body pain, and such symptoms come, definitely you have to approach a doctor. And that means we have a lot of things to do with this immunity part and post-COVID scenario. Generally, you might have heard of one word called rasayana. Rasayana, usually people interpret with antioxidants, rejuvenation, and immunomodulators, and so many other words. I'm not sure whether these words are sufficient to substantiate the meaning of rasayana. It has got an immense meaning. That means it has got the protective capacity starting from the subtlest level to the gross level. So that's what the property of rasayana is. Generally, when we take the community as a whole, we have four category of people. One is the people, though they are exposed to this viral infection, they are not getting the fever, they are not getting the COVID. And the second category is they are exposed, they are affected with COVID-19, and at the same time, they are asymptomatic. Is it not? And third category is the same people, COVID positive people, are asymptomatic and they are having a lot of complications. And fourth category of people are, they are getting into complications and unfortunately they are dying. So that means it is the same problem, it is the same COVID virus, it is the same individuals, it is the same disease, same body. So why this differentiation? That is very important. So Ayurveda has an answer to say, Ayurveda has a theory to say behind that. There are two types of immunity. One thing is called as Vyadhi Ulpadaka Pratibandhakatvam. That means it will arrest the entry of a disease. So any disease will be stopped from the entry level itself. If such a resistance is there, that first category of people will be protected. In the second and third category, so asymptomatic patients and the symptomatic patients, these two patients have Vyadhi Bala Virodhitvam. That means they have the resistance, they have the immunity to protect the disease, protect against the disease. That is called these two categories are. If these two types of immunities are not there, definitely one will unfortunately fall into death. That is the generally Ayurvedic principle regarding the immunity part. And how a virus can get lodged into a body? That is another question. So I would like to tell the case of river. You know river. What is the function of river? What is the responsibility of river? It is to flow uninterruptedly. So if that flow has been interrupted, definitely that water will be lodged, water will be collected and contaminated. And there is every chance that the creatures, insects and mosquito-like things, that will start growing in that putrefied water, contaminated water. You see, in that case, the same way, metaphorically, we can consider our body as a lot of a system through which a lot of rivers are crossing through. I'm just telling as an imaginative this thing. So in that way, what will happen? These rivers can be compared with our transportation system. These rivers can be compared with our internal transport srotas, channels and all, through which our blood circulation is there and lymphatic circulation is there. And also, you see, the transportation of chemicals are there. So all these things are happening through these channels or through this internal transportation system. So in case, as I mentioned you in the case of river, if that river, I mean, channels are blocked, what will happen? There will be a stage of contamination, there will be a stage of impurity, and this is the best area where the virus or other pathogens get afflicted on a body. In such a way, it is our primary responsibility to clean these channels very periodically. Cleaning means it is purifying the channels. For that, Ayurveda says one word called Panchakarma. It is the procedural aspects of five therapies. So this Panchakarma will definitely help you to clean these channels. It is very important to clean these internal channels. There are three levels of channels. I'll come to that later on. So Ayurveda, the synonym of health in Ayurveda is Sukha. Su means good. Ga means channels. So if the quality of channels are good, definitely your body health is appropriate. Appropriate means it is in the perfect form. So that is why the role of Panchakarma is very important in the cases of channel cleansing. And I would like, in this particular juncture, I would like to borrow the statement of our respected trustee and additional chief physician, Dr. Murali Sar. He was stating in one particular article that, can you imagine our Gandhiji, father of nation, as healthy? Or a person who is seeing from outside, or a third person, with all due respects to Gandhiji, a third person may just think that he is not that healthy, seeing his appearance. But he is the only person who has traveled by walk throughout India, not this time, then India, then it has a vast area. That much area he has covered by walk. So it is only due, and we have never heard that he was sick at any point of time. So that means this immunity and body, I mean, physique is entirely different. We have seen so many six pack people or people with a lot of muscle bulk having COVID positive, COVID-19. So this muscle bulk has got nothing to do with this immunity. I'm not telling that to do, but it is not directly proportional. That's what I am going to say. And also the people who have six pack, they are also affected with COVID-19. So this immunity word and the body structure, of course, this structure or this physique is connected with our systems, our tissues, like connected with our tissues, like muscles, bones, and so on. But immunity has something beyond to say. Actually, you see, it is actually the energy of the person in a cellular level. I would like to categorize our body into three compartments. One is our physical body, what we see from externally. That is the gross body. So the energy is very important for all these systems. For example, our liver, brain, kidney, heart, every system energy is important. But is that only sufficient? With what these systems or our external body is made with? It is made with the body tissues. These body tissues also have an equal role for the contribution of energy. So we call it as Jatharagni. Jatharagni means it is the fire, it is the energy level, it can be compared with enzymes, hormones, and so on. And in that case, this Agni or fire or energy can contribute a lot into a physical thing. The same way, the tissue level, the Dhatvakni, Dhatu means both body tissues, Dhatvakni can also contribute a lot of things for the energy part and for the immunity part. And which what that Dhatu has been, I mean, constituted, it is constituted with cells. So the cells also should have an energy. Those cells should also have a fire. It should also have an ojas. We call it as ojas. So this ojas is, ojas means we can compare with immunity again. It is the prime responsibility for all this immunity in a nutshell. So I was, with these a few words, I was just trying to give you a clear important information that how this immunity is interpreted in Ayurvedic point of view. And definitely we will come with more points when the question and answers are coming up. And of course, thank you so much, Dr. Anu. I will pass on this mic to Dr. Anu. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Now we have received a number of queries regarding the current today's topic. Especially most of the queries are being usually asked by the general public. So I would like to pass on these to the expert panel. Sir, let me start with Ramesh sir. Sir, would you please address to these queries? Ramesh sir? Sir, can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, very well.
Yes. So one of the most commonest query which is asked is, because nowadays there are more of rules and regulations interested. So everybody would like to know about the vulnerable category of patients. Basically, there is a vulnerable category, especially to this COVID. And they would also like to know about the lifestyle changes which is required as a preventive measure, at least. Dr. Ullas has clearly explained. Sir, can you just practically mention what are the things which can be followed nowadays?
Yeah. Of course, we all know that the vulnerable categories are, one is shy children, another is elderly people. So the first thing is personal hygiene and environmental cleanliness. That is, everybody knows that. So we have to be very, very careful in having these two shuddhis for maintaining our health, one thing. Second thing is about nutrition, having good nutrition. I'm not at all talking about taking medicines. Having a regular routine in your life, like Ullas was telling about Dinacharya, Ritucharya and all. But in Dinacharya, if you have a daily routine, because if you follow a daily routine, body will maintain a biological rhythm. And when you eat, because the personal hygiene we have already discussed, when you eat, please find that actually both the people who are taking that and the people who are feeding them should have an idea that we should give them a balanced diet, a nutritious diet, so that it will protect them. And the digestive part, Dr. Rajagopalan has beautifully described about the concept of digestion and srotas in Ayurveda. So that part is very, very important, because keeping a vibrant, dynamic metabolism, vibrant immune system, you should just, is supposed to be the maximum or optimum functional or fittest state of a person. So maintaining that, achieving that is very, very difficult. But when you eat properly, when you do regular exercises, when you have stress-free mind, when you have adequate sleep, so that your immune system as well as body and mind is getting proper rest, and having adequate water. And of course, all these things, because I was thinking about the microbiota, that is also very, very important in immunity. Microbiota, everything is not in our hand, because we have lot of bacteria inside our large intestine and in other parts of the body, which are actually helping us to have a good metabolism and as well as a vibrant dynamic immunity. So for that, what do we do? Because it is not fully in our hand. But if you avoid all kinds of this artificially flavored things, junk food, which can kill the bacteria inside. So have natural thing and natural. So the traditional diet can never be a problem for anybody, because we have been following that. So stick on to that, give prominence, give importance to that kind of thing. And having good stress-free mind. So that is where you should have a good relation with your family members, friends, and neighbors. Having a good relationship make you happy and make your immune system very vibrant. So this is in a nutshell. But along with that, we can have certain medications, because it is always better to consult a doctor before taking any medications. But of course, if you don't have any problem, because many people will be having diabetes, hypertension, and heart related issues and all. So you cannot directly go and purchase Chyawanprash and take that. Always consult a experienced Ayurvedic physician. He will guide you what to do. But the home remedy, just that again, Villas has very clearly mentioned, including herbal teas, preparing herbal teas, which improves your digestive fire, and having, some items like Indukantham, Chyawanprash, Brahmarasayanam, if you are otherwise okay, and if your digestive power is okay, that will help you to protect from the disease-causing agent in a nutshell. And that individual variations are there. That is where a doctor can help. This in a nutshell, I would like to tell. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Sir, may I put forward some questions to you, Rajagopal, sir?
Sure.
Actually, nowadays, the whole fraternity, whoever affected with COVID or not affected, all were cautious about the post-COVID complication. In fact, last doctor has mentioned some of that. But still, what will be the possible complication which we can expect in this type of scenario? And Ramesh sir has earlier mentioned about the necessity of a vibrant immune system. So could you please just concise to the diet pattern, especially when coming to the Kerala and other aspects, there are different food system available. So can you please mention these two things? Can you please provide a better idea?
Thank you, Dr. Anod. Regarding the post-COVID complications, till now we are not in a position to conclude. Conclusively, we cannot say that these are the symptoms or these could be the complications due to the COVID-19 infection. So why? Because even now the scenario is going on. So that has not finished. That problem has not finished. So from so many studies, so many journals, so many opinions from expert doctors, it is understood so far. It is understood that the problem related to lungs, that was what our respected health minister was also mentioning. I initially told you. So most of the problems may get affected with lungs. That is what most of the physicians' opinion is. In that case, and that could be due to liver, I mean, lung fibrosis. That could be due to, ILD, interstitial lung disease. We are not sure, but still, the possibilities goes on like that. And there could be recurrent lung infections also. And their immune system will be not working properly, so that they may get recurrent fever, evening rise of temperature, their energy level may be low, and they may get chronic fatigue syndrome. Like that, there are a series of diseases which are expected after the COVID-19 is finished. But till now, we are not in a conclusive stage. In that case, what we should do in the diet? That was the second question. Actually, we should not expose to too much of cold weather. That is one thing. For example, our upper respiratory tract should be well protected whenever you go outside. For example, if you go in an AC car and you go to the area where high altitude is there, and whenever you go for a tour or something, in such conditions, you should take care of your nasal cavity and mouth and ears very well. And when we come to the food part, generally cold things like fridge water, ice cream, cool drinks, these kind of items should be restricted as much as possible, because these on long term can create upset in your lungs and also upper respiratory tract. And also things like curd. Curd would not be a good choice in this condition. You can make use of buttermilk, that also boiled with a little turmeric powder and salt and curry leaves. All these things have to be boiled, and that buttermilk can be taken instead of taking curd. Curd is not good. And cheese, butter, those kind of fat-rich items, which the things which contains a lot of fat, those things also it is better to be avoided. And it is always better to reduce the quantity of sweets you are taking. Sweets in the sense like jalebi, laddu, those kind of so many sweets are available nowadays. So I'm telling you from the point of Ayurveda. So these things can definitely create a lot of kapha. Kapha means, kapha is the dosha. Kapha is the humor, body humor, which is responsible for creating all sort of these kind of allergic manifestations. In that way, the things which have probable chance of increasing this kapha should be reduced. That's why I told you to reduce these bakery items. And also from my experience, I have seen that yaggi is not supposed to be good. If you take, for example, children also, if they take too much of egg also, in them, this allergic situation is more. And also the other small banana like plantain, that also is allergic to certain people. And we have to, from the observation, we have to find out whether they people are not suiting with gluten items like milk and meat products. These things we should be very careful about. Highly depends upon their personal life also. And regarding what should be taken, you have to take everything warm and fresh. Dr. Ramesh was beautifully telling about the traditional food habits. That is very important. At the same time, take everything fresh. That is very important. And Dr. Ullas mentioned, don't overeat. Take food only after digesting the previous meals. That is the main theme of the food. In that way, you have to take care of your food timing also. And the other thing is, too much of red chilies and fried items, tamarind, and things are very difficult to get digested. These things should be better to be avoided. And also, you can make use of green chilies, pepper, ginger, garlic, turmeric powder, coriander. All those things you can take in sufficient quantity. So there are certain things to be taken, certain things to be reduced, certain things to be avoided also. So these things, a final picture, you may please ask with a doctor who you are consulting and get a final picture, a clear picture. Then you have to go accordingly. But definitely, food and diet has got a good role in the maintenance of health part after the COVID scenario.
Thank you, sir. Sir, there is a little bit more to this discussion. Sir, you have mentioned about the rasayanas as well. Sir, even Ramesh sir has mentioned the Chavanaprasha and the dosage, as everything has to be fixed as per the advice of a physician only. So there are little bit queries, especially regarding to the children, those vulnerable group, whether it is possible to give Chavanaprasha to the children. So can you please put a more light on this topic, sir?
To whom, Dr. Anu?
Sir, Rajagopal sir.
Okay. So usually, Ayurveda particularly says all medicines are meant for all categories. For example, if it is Chavanaprasha, that can be given for children. And only thing is dose should be in different form. We have to give the particular dose and considering their age and their balam means strength and their suitability, all those things has to be considered and the dose should be fixed. Only change is the dose. But at the same time, I think Chyawanprasha, for a baby of below 1 year, I don't know whether they will take it also, but in that case, below 1 year is not that recommended. After 1 year, definitely the Chyawanprasha can be given. They should be given that culture of taking that Chyawanprasha by giving a small quantity of Chyawanprasha. For example, children, what they do, they will actually imitate their parents. So the best way to make them feed medicine is you just show them, the parents should show them how to take medicines so that they will be attracted to it and they will start taking it in a small dose. We know that there is no harm in taking Chyawanprasha, but if our dose is 5 to 10 grams, the children's dose should be 1 to 2 grams only up to the age of 5 years. And after 5 years, you can slowly increase also. And how long to be taken and which time to be taken is absolutely under the direct decision of a physician. So definitely you have to consult a doctor. That is very important. But generally, I can tell you this much. Of course, all the medicines which are prescribed for an adult person are recommended for children also, but only thing is dose matters.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for making it clarified for the public also. Sir, I think we have almost come to the end of the session, actually. But before that, I would like to invite our additional chief physician and superan, Dr. Murali, sir, to share his views on this topic, sir. Sir, please.
Can you hear me now?
Yes sir, we can.
We have three wonderful speeches and explanation of the queries asked. They have nothing much to add to all these things. But one thing I would like to just present is this morning when we were attending the seminar conducted by the Ayush department, our Modiji, in which Modiji gave us a beautiful talk. During the course of that event, Director General of World Health Organization assured that they are going to set up a center for traditional, global center for traditional medicine in India. Being an Indian, we are all very happy to hear that. That was the most important news I received this morning. And again, not only that, Modiji was telling India is going to be the pharmacy of the world and India is going to be a center for global wellness. This is a right kind of assurance we can expect from our authorities on a very auspicious day. So we are going to have a final stage of this celebration of the Nidhi. That is the general thing I have to tell you. And another, we were all discussing about so many medicines here. And one of these days, my friend asked me one question. Do you believe that this Ayushpada Churnam is going to be effective to control this or prevent this virus and all that? What is your justification? I was a little amazed to take that question. Rather perplexed. I was not amazed, but a little perplexed. How to answer this gentleman with a proper answer? Then I thought of thinking about this Ayushpada Churnam. Basically, what is it? It is a bag of enzyme promoters. You just look at the ingredients of Ayushpada Churnam. There are enzyme promoters. Oh, then the question comes, what is the use of enzymes here? What the enzymes are going to do with this virus infection? That is very important. According to Ayurveda, that's very important function which we have to ignite. Because once you get an infection, what happens? What happens really? The chemical reactions in the body become very sluggish. That is what is happening. Ayurveda call it ama and all that. It is a dismetabolic status. That is a breeding ground for virus, bacteria and all that. That makes all the problem according to our system of medicine. That is very evident also. So what we have to do is, what according to our science we have to do is, ignite your energy in whichever be the form. And that is what we are doing with it. Then he was partially convinced. Then another question came, can you give me just one example? There is an example. Because the most complicated cases of COVID are seen in diabetic patients. Hope I am right in my understanding. There, this particular piperin, the biological piperin, dietary piperin, pepper very specifically act on pancreas. And also, all other ingredients about cinnamon also, it has got a very specific antibacterial, antiviral, even antifungal activity. So it's a multi-pronged approach. Ayushkodak food churnam contains all these things. So that is a multi-pronged approach that is to try to deal with the infection and also to improve our metabolism. When we speak of an infection, what we understand, there is a lot of metabolic stress. This particular medicine, Ayushkodha Churna, will counter the metabolic stress and bring back the body to the normalcy. That is the answer I could find out from referring to some books and also from my own thought experiments, I should say. That is the answer I got for this. And I think it is relevant to tell about Ayushkodha Churna, the mode of action of Ayushkodha Churna at this platform, if I just sounded it here. And also, I'm not going to the details, but again, I can tell you, the action of Ayushkodha Churna is not confined to COVID alone. There are a few examples, a few experiences. After giving Ayushkodha Churna, you just get the blood parameters tested, including sugar, cholesterol, such things, and you will see definitely favorable changes. What does it mean? It primarily acts on the basic metabolic setup. That way it helps. It is not a medicine equivalent to particular antiviral drug. No, not at all. It's fully tallied with Ayurvedic approach and Ayurvedic concepts. That point has to be highlighted. It should reach the common people. And only they will understand. Not only that, again, I have one more point to add here. Because it is going to be a medicine for the post-COVID complications too. That we have to prove it later. We have to conduct a very detailed study about this Ayushkodha Churna, which has been brought out by the government of India after a very serious discussion. Ayurvedashala, as any other institution, has undertaken the responsibility of marketing it in a very beautiful way. It is well accepted. And it is well accepted. Why? It has proved its efficacy. So that is an important thing which I would like to share with you now. Dr. Ulyas has done a very good job. Very precisely has presented the thing. And Dr. Ramesh, as usual, very beautifully explained the background. And Dr. Rajagopalan was very clear in his statements. And the questions raised were quite good. Dr. Anu has done her job very nicely. I have nothing more to add here. I congratulate all of you. And let us pray Lord Dhanudri before concluding this session. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir, for giving a wonderful perspective to the Aishwarya Jurna. Thank you so much. And now, as sir has said, we have almost come to the end of the session. For the attendees, thank you so much for participating in this webinar and for being with us until the end. And for any personal queries, you may reach out to our medical team by sending a mail to our mail ID, mail@arivedishala.com. And our doctors are available in the video consultation also. You can send a hi message to them through your WhatsApp to 94001902. And a direct video consultation is also available through our website, www.arivedishala.com. Please access to that also. And for any non-medical queries, please reach out to our marketing department through marketing@arivedishala.com. So with this, we have come to the end. Thank you all for participating, and thank you for the expert panel for a wonderful explanation and contributing so much to the current topic. Thank you so much. Thank you, sirs.
Thank you. Thank you.